Anatomy has a lot of terminology in it. Our first set of terminology to cover helps describe the locations of things in the body, or locations of things relative to one another, or different views we can take inside the body. These reference terms are based on something called anatomical position. Position where the body is standing erect, looking toward you with the eyes facing forward, arms out at the side, and the palms of the hands and the tips of the feet facing forward, as shown in this lovely picture of a skeleton. That anatomical position is used as the reference for our anatomical terms, regardless of the real-world body position. So we have a couple of terms, for example, like supine for somebody who is lying down and face up, like a patient might be lying down in a bed, or the term prone for someone who's lying down and face down, like you might see on some sort of cop drama or something. We have a term superior, which generally speaking means up, but in anatomical position, that's toward the head, regardless of the actual position of the body. So if a body is laying down in supine position, superior is still toward the head on that body, even though superior is no longer up in the real world. So here's a few different images stolen off of the internet. One of these individuals is in a proper anatomical position, and it's the guy in the blue t-shirt in the lower left box. Here's a figure from the book indicating some of our terminology for either directions of objects relative to each other, or movements that anatomical structures can take during speech articulation, for example. And again, these are relative to anatomical position. So anterior and posterior, for example, anterior would be more toward the front, posterior would be more toward the back of the person in anatomical position. As I mentioned before, superior is up when you're standing up. Inferior is the opposite of that, down toward the feet. We also have terms medial and lateral that kind of cover the left-right direction, but medial is toward the middle and lateral is away from the middle, whether that is to the left or right. So we don't actually really have an equivalent of left and right that's asymmetric. There are some alternative terms that are used that are similar to these, more often with a fetus or with animals, where the standing erect upright anatomical position isn't so typical. The term ventral used for things away from the backbone, and dorsal for things toward the backbone. Rostral or cranial or cephalic for things toward the head, and caudal for things that are toward the tail. Another set of terms outside of those basic dimensions from anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, and medial lateral get into more the three-dimensional structure of the body, you might say. So we have superficial for things that are more toward the surface of the body, like your nose, for example, and deep for things that are farther away from the surface, like your brain or your spinal column. We also have external and internal that are pretty much the same thing as superficial and deep. They just tend to get used with different types of anatomical structures, like body cavities, as opposed to other sorts of body parts. As far as you all are concerned, you don't really have to worry about the distinction of which one people tend to use. As long as you can recognize what the term means, you're good. Similarly, we have terms proximal and distal, where proximal is toward the body or the central part of the organism, and distal would be away from that. So that tends to get used for like the arms and the legs, where your fingers and toes would be distal, your shoulder joint and your hip joint would be proximal. And again, similar terminology, central and peripheral. Again, central for things that are more toward the inside, and peripheral for things that are more toward the outside. Also, in terms of meaning, basically synonyms for superficial and deep, or external and internal. One of the most important parts of our terminology for directions are the planes of reference. So you may have informally heard about the world being a three-dimensional space. Most images that you're going to look at on a screen or in a book have to be in two dimensions, because that's the way screens and pieces of paper work. So whenever we're looking inside a body, for example, it's useful to know which plane of reference our two-dimensional image is in. So we have the three-dimensional world divided up into three different planes: a sagittal plane that divides basically the left and right parts. There's a very special sagittal plane called the mid-sagittal plane, where it exactly divides things into halves, left and right, and we'll use mid-sagittal planes inside the head to look at articulators like the tongue quite a bit in this class. A coronal or frontal plane is a plane that separates the front part of something from the back part of something, and the transverse plane divides the upper part of something from the lower part of something. On this slide, I've included both the image from the book showing those planes, as well as one scanned in from an older book that shows the body actually, physically divided by those planes to give you an idea of how those planes work. So between those three planes, we can look, inside of someone from the front or from behind, from above or from below, from the left or from the right. So to test your understanding of these concepts, again, we could imagine being outside of anatomical position, laying on the floor face up in a supine position. When I do that, then what direction would actually be up toward the ceiling among my various anatomical directions? Pause for dramatic effect. Laying on the floor face up, anterior would be up toward the ceiling. And if I think about when I'm laying on the floor, which plane the floor would represent relative to my anatomical position, that would be a coronal plane or a frontal plane, because if I were to sink into the floor, that would divide my body into front and back parts.